السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، صلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا، ثم ما بعد. So the hadith that we have tonight is actually a very famous hadith for all of you. But subhanAllah, it's an amazing story. This is one of the hadith that gives us a great hope in repenting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, regardless how much we think that we have messed up in our lives. Regardless how much we think our mistakes are, you know, too grave to be forgiven, Allah's forgiveness is just amazing, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what is this story? Let's hear it from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imam al-Nawawi, rahimahullah ta'ala, says in Kitab al-Tawbah, قال وعن أبي سعيد سعد بن مالك بن سنان الخدري رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال كان في من كان قبلكم رجل قتل 99 نفسا. He said, there was a person from among the nation and the people who were before you who killed 99 innocent souls. What do you call this in our time, Jama'ah? Wallah, even serial killers is under it's more than just serial killer, Allah musta'an. A psychopath, a murderer, a crazy, whatever you want to call it. SubhanAllah, someone just killing 99 people just like that, for whatever reason, rob them, just for pleasure of it, Allah musta'an. So this man, he killed 99 people. Now, if you think about someone who kills 99 people, can they even think of recovery? Would it even be possible after getting that path and you watch yourself killing 99 individuals? Would they even think of recovery or hope or getting out of that mess in their lives? So this man, he thought there would be no hope whatsoever after 99 innocent people lost their lives on the hand of this individual. قال فسأل عن أعلم أهل الأرض. So, of course, definitely a question like this requires what? An expert. He needed to know if his situation can be rectified, if there is a remedy for his dilemma. So he asked about the most knowledgeable person. He didn't go to the average imam. He didn't go to the average person in his neighborhood. No, he wanted someone who could really give him the answer, once and for all. So give me the answer from the expert. فَسَأَلَ عَنْ أَعْلَمِ أَهْلِ الْأَرْضِ فَدُلَّ عَلَى رَاهِبٍ. He asked about the most knowledgeable person in the area. فَدُلَّ عَلَى رَاهِبٍ. They told him there's a monk in such and such area, like he's a religious person, he's a man of God, go and talk to him. فَذَهَبَ إِلَيْهِ فَأَتَاهُ فَقَالَ إِنَّهُ قَتَلَ 99 نَفْسًا. So he told him, I killed 99 people. Is there any chance for me to repent? Can I repent so Allah accept my repentance? فَقَالَ لَا. This man, he was petrified. He was horrified by the intensity of the crime and the sin of this individual. He said, no way. Like, you kidding me? Yeah, you're killing 99 people and Allah will forgive you? SubhanAllah. مَنْ يَتَأَلَّ عَلَى اللَّهِ. How could this man even overstep his limits and speak on behalf of the Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala? So he told this man, no, there is no room for repentance for you. فَقَتَلَهُ فَكَمَّلَ بِهِ الْمِئَةِ. The man, he thought, okay then, here you go. Finish the guy, he made him 100. Like if there is no hope, this guy doesn't deserve to be alive then. So he killed him, subhanAllah. Even in a moment like this, he was coming for repentance. He's coming back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. On the path, on the way to return to Allah, he's still making mistakes. For those brothers and sisters who are trying their best to return back to Allah and repent, and they keep tripping over and over again, don't you ever stop trying. Don't you ever stop moving forward to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This man, on the path of returning to Allah, still continued doing the same sin. And a sin like this, like destroying an innocent life. SubhanAllah. فَقَتَلُهُ فَأَكْمَلَ فَكَمَّلَ بِهِ الْمِئَةِ ثُمَّ سَأَلَ عَنْ أَعْلَمِ أَهْلِ الْأَرْضِ. After some time, he couldn't stop. He couldn't stop thinking about returning to Allah Azza wa Jal. So he went back again and asked the people, is there anybody else better than this guy? Eventually, they said, فَدُلَّ عَلَى رَجُلٍ عَالِمٍ. Now the first one was عَلَى رَجُلٍ عَلَى رَاهِبٍ, a monk who's a worshipper, a pious person. who thought that piety is in the form of, you know, devotion, constant devotion worship. He was asked, فَدُلَّ عَلَى رَجُلٍ عَالِمٍ. They sent him to a scholar. And those two words, rahib and scholar, rahib means monk, alim means scholar, gives a difference between being a devotee, a worshipper, and a scholar. A devotee, his benefit is on himself. A alim, his khair radiates to all over the world, everybody who's around him. And there's many ahadith, we're going to come to them later, inshallah ta'ala, in the course of discussing, you know, Riyadu Saliheen, the difference and the virtue of the alim over the worshipper. So this is the difference between that. So this man, he answered based on his emotions. Like, there's no way someone kills 99 people and they will be forgiven. But the alim, he told him, and who's going to prevent you? When he came to this alim, he went to him and he told him what he did, that he killed 100. فَهَلِّي مِنْ تَوْبَةٍ. Is there any chance for me to repent and my repentance would be accepted? فَقَالَ لَهُ نَعَمْ وَمَنْ يَحُولُ بَيْنَكَ وَبَيْنَ التَّوْبَةِ. He says, who can even stop you from repenting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Now some of us might think, you know, if we think bad, we said, subhanAllah, maybe he told him because he thought he's going to finish him. Right? But that's a alim who's answering a jama'ah. A alim who's going to give the answer, and he puts his trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He told him, absolutely, who is going to stop you from repenting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Qala, so he didn't just give him the answer to his question. He gave him the solution for his problem. And that is Jawab al-Hakim, the answer of the wise man. He gave him the answer to his question, and he gave him more. Solution for his problem. He said, انطلق إلى أرض كذا وكذا. فإن بها أناسا يعبدون الله تعالى فاعبد الله معهم ولا ترجع إلى أرضك فإنها أرض سوء. He said, you need to get out of this town. You live in a terrible place. A place that has a lot of triggers, a lot of reminders, a lot of bad friends, a lot of intense incentives that would make you to make the mistake over and over again. He says, move out of this place. Get out of this place. وَذْهَبْ إِلَى أَرْضِ كَذَا وَكَذَا. Go to such and such area or village or town. فَإِنَّ بِهَا أُنَاسًا يَعْبُدُونَ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى. That place has good community and they worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, go and worship Allah Azza Jal with them and don't come back to this town. So the man, he took that seriously and he moved out right away. On the way to that town where he was supposed to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with the people of that place, he, حتى إذا انتصف الطريق, مات. On halfway through, of course, his journey, the man died. For whatever reason. قال فمات. فأتاه الموت. فاختصمت فيه ملائكة الرحمة وملائكة العذاب. The angels of death and the angels of mercy and the angels of torment, they start arguing about him. The angel of mercy, they said, he came back to Allah. He was on his way to repent. The angels of torment, they say, he never did anything good yet. Still, nothing on his record to show that he deserves it. So they argued over him. And of course, each has, of course, you know, their case. Those who say he's coming to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that by itself overrides all his bad deeds. And those who say, well, nothing confirmed yet. He's still in the process. So we don't even know if he was genuine to this repentance or not. So how could we just accept him as someone forgiven? To Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah azza wa jal, he sent him an angel fi surati Adami. So an angel in a human form came down to them. فَجَعَلُوهُ بَيْنَهُمْ. They asked him to kind of, what would you say in this position? فَقَالَ أُنْظُرُ. He said, look and measure the distance between the two lands. فَإِلَىٰ أَيِّهِمَا أَقْرَبْ فَهُوَ ذَلِكَ. Where is he going to be closer? Then that would be his destination. If he was closer to the town where he was going to, that means, alhamdulillah, he's forgiven. If he was still closer to the town where he was leaving from, means too late for him. So when they measured the distance, they found him closer to where he was going. So the angels of mercy took him with them. In some other narration, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala actually brought the distance closer to where he was going as part of the show of mercy from Allah azza wa jal, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would want to accept him. So in this case, فَقَبْرَتْهُ مَلَائِكَةُ الرَّحْمَةِ. The angels of mercy, they took him with them. Now, subhanAllah, what is the moral of the story, Jama? What do you guys learn from the story? Huh? It is never too late to return back to Allah Azza wa Jalla. Okay, what about, you know, how grave the mistake or the sin is? Does it matter to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? But I messed up all my life. I've never done anything good. Would Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive me? Of course. Who's going to stop you? No one's going to stop you but yourself from returning back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But I know myself, I'm so bad. Even when I'm trying, I keep tripping. So, it's useless. Never give up. As long as you keep heading and moving towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, just like in the story of this man, there was another narration, that this man, they found his chest was, he fell on his face toward the direction of that town where he was going. Similarly, in a moral way, of course, you know, in the actually figurative speech, I would say, make sure that if you fall, that you fall towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not the opposite direction. Regardless of what you do, you always turn to Allah Azza wa Jalla, so that if you fall dead at some point in life, you're falling towards Him subhanahu wa ta'ala, not away from Him. There is no sin that cannot be forgiven except for the shirk associated part of Allah Azza wa Jalla. And of course, there is no sin that is greater than the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Always look at that from the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jalla, and all your sins will be little, inshallah. بإذن الله تبارك وتعالى. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us among those who listen to the speech and follow the best of it. And those who frequently return back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to give us the ability to repent to Him over and over again. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept the repentance that we do. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us to stay away from that which displeases Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And keep us always close to that which pleases Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wallahu a'lam. Any question, Jama'ah? Fadal.
The malaika, they disagree on something. Mm-hmm. And then they ask a wise man why they didn't go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because they are getting the command from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to do whatever they are doing. But they are not getting it by somebody who's just walking and tell them, you know, like, do this or do that.
So why the angel did not go back to Allah Azza when they argued? Instead they waited for someone to give them, to arbitrate between them, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by His hikmah and His wisdom, He sends these angels. Now the question, these angels, did they come in the human form as well? It seems to be actually that they came in that form to receive Him. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent them an angel, also in a human form. Wallahu a'lam. But why didn't they go back to Allah Azza wa Jal? This is for us to learn that lesson. Just like in Surah Al-Baqarah, Harut and Marut, two angels came down to teach people what? As-sihr, magic. And when people come to them, they would warn them, listen, we are trial, we are test over here for you. So stay away from us. So even though they're actually in the human form, they're still angels. And that's by the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for a wisdom, for a hikmah, we don't really probably understand 100%. So Allahu a'lam. Na'am, fadal. Are you a lawyer or a prosecutor? So basically, we understand Allah forgive this man who killed 100 people, right? What's going to happen to the 100 people who died? I mean, like, seriously? This man, he killed them all, and he's going to go to Al-Jannah? Like, if they meet him in Al-Jannah, what's going to happen? Like, you killed me. How come you're here now? Subhanallah. That's a valid question, right? Remember, everything happens by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah azza wa jal will judge these people and give them the reward that they deserve. He will give them the reward that they deserve, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, but how could it be? I mean, the murderer and the victim are on the same level of Jannah, for example. When they meet, are they going to have any issues in their hearts against each other? Absolutely not. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran that there will be no hard feelings, no grudge whatsoever in Al-Jannah, you know, among the people of Al-Jannah. And you would say, but that's not fair. I mean, in the scale of human beings, probably. But with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah knows best. As long as everybody takes their reward, and everybody takes what they deserve, yani in terms of the reward, khalas, what's the problem with that? Should be fine. Wallahu a'lam. Na'am. Yes. Okay.
This narration does not say that Allah, you know, what happens to those 99 people.
So when it comes to حقوق العباد, basically you're saying that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive this individual if the human forgives first, right? Is that what you're saying? Well, not ultimately, not in that fashion. Yani, for example, what if I made the mistake against someone and I went to this individual asking for forgiveness and I'm paying his money back to him, and this guy says, I don't want to take the money. I'll take it for him on judgment day. But yaakhi, I'm sorry, here's your money back, and I ask Allah to forgive me for what I've done. And the man insists not to forgive this individual. Is that individual who's repenting, is he going to be held accountable for that right now? The answer is actually, wallahu alam, no. Meaning, if you did your part by repenting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala first and foremost, and then try to rectify the situation by going to the individual to give them their haqq back, and they insisted on refusing and not accepting, it's up to them. But that would be between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. However, you should keep doing your best. Ask Allah for forgiveness from the mistake you've done against this human being. And if Allah accepts your repentance, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will compensate that human being on judgment day for the haqq that was taken from them in dunya. Because I tried my best, you refused to accept my repentance, or at least my apology on that part, and fixing the situation. So yes, we say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah Azza will forgive you, his huquq, but he will suspend the huquq of al-ibad until the ibad themselves, they accept that, provided that the person did not repent to Allah Azza wa Jalla. But if he repented, that's between him and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nah.
But what happens in this court, the dunya court, like let's say this person is brought to the court, and the person refuses to accept his forgiveness,
Definitely, if in dunya court, if this man, for example, killed 99 or 100 people, he was brought to the court of justice at this time, for example, even though he says, Imam, I killed 100 and I apologize for this, there's still the court can actually execute him for it. Why? Because now it's a haqq al-ibad and haqq the society right now, if this is the case. Wallahu a'lam. Yes. The only sin that's not forgiven. Once they convert, everything, all the sins in the past are forgiven. Wallahu a'lam. Yes. Last question, inshallah. So people, they put you saying the Quran as the ringtones? Apps? Oh, if you have an app on your cell phone that has Quran in it, and you get into the bathroom, that's fine. As long as it's not on the screen actually. If it's not on the screen, it should be fine, inshallah ta'ala. Ringtone, that's a problem. I don't like anyone to put any dua, any dhikr, anything as a ringtone, jama'ah. It's disrespect for the dua, and sometimes we'll be ringing actually the wrong time. Especially if you're going to have to turn it off and interrupt in the ayah or the dua or the dhikr. So therefore, just keep it for yourself. Don't use it as a ringtone. Even the adhan. Just make it basically instead of a ringtone, a vibration. That's it. That's more than enough, inshallah, to remind you. والله أعلم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.